Hollywood. Matías Bombal with you. Roadside Attractions, a division of Lionsgate, offers a release from River Road Entertainment, Love and Mercy, a story of composer and pop star Brian Wilson, who reached early fame as part of the iconic pop music group The Beach Boys, whose popularity in the 1960s and through the present is part of the very fabric of culture in the United States. This movie gains an inside track of authenticity as screenwriters Michael A. Lerner and Oren Moverman had the subject, Brian Wilson, as a co-author. In the story, which is told in period flashbacks as well as a more modern section of crisis in Mr. Wilson's life in the early 1980s, two actors play the role of Mr. Wilson. The first, the young Brian, is brought to life by Paul Dano. The Wilson of the 1980s, a broken man, over-medicated and controlled by the unscrupulous Dr. Eugene Landy, is played brilliantly by John Cusack. Interestingly, neither look much like the real person, but this is a movie, a story, and it does not end up mattering much that the likeness is not the same. You rapidly forget that as you become engrossed in the story. Director Bill Pohland has crafted a remarkable movie here, so much so that for this review, I'm compelled to take you behind the scenes. If everybody had an
ocean across the USA. He was doing things that were so otherworldly and shaped culture in such incredible ways.
It has two actors playing the central character.
There's an interpretation of two eras in his life. The super creative era of the 60s.
Got all kinds of new ideas, new sounds, new harmonies.
And the psychologically complicated era of the 80s.
It's my job to approve anyone that Brian is spending time with.
I hear voices. I just didn't tell you because I didn't want to scare you away.
Brian in the 80s was not Brian in the 60s.
Roll sound.
I loved getting in that sandbox. Sitting at the piano.
If you don't know the Beach Boys well or Brian Wilson's work very well, you tend to think of the Beach Boys as surf music. His genius is that he hears these complex harmonies that no one else can really hear.
With live musicians and a mic, and he's bouncing sounds off his walls.
A higher octave on the upbeats and the bridge.
Let's add a little tie right here.
How does that work? Two bass lines and two different keys?
Well, it works in my head. It's
weird. It was big to shoot in Los Angeles. It's a very California story.
We filmed our studio scenes in the studio they did Pet Sounds in.
They're standing on the same linoleum floor with the, you know, same things on the wall. It just makes it so real.
Hey, guys. Hey.
To see him walk in the room was very cool. I was really nervous. He's such a strong spirit. If we can capture even a fraction of that, we've got something.
Good, we got that part. Cut it. I want to move to Gold Star for the next part.
I may not always love you.
The story is not just about music. I think it's about survival. I think it's about compassion. And I think it's about love.
A big part of it was Melinda Ledbetter, his wife, giving him strength and confidence.
The most beautiful things in the world are the things that are shattered, and broken, and then mended back together.
Sometimes your inner voice wants to express itself.
God only knows what I'd be without.
Every once in a while, every blue moon, your soul comes out to play.
God only knows what I'd be without.
This movie is very special. It gets into that thin line between madness and genius that touches rarely in creative people. The performances are all solid. Not overly remarkable, but solid. Paul Giamatti is Dr. Levy, playing a real person who is easy to dislike, and easy, I think, for Giamatti to render. Both Brian Wilsons are very good, but I found the subtlety of the older Wilson, as played by John Cusack, to be among my favorite of his performances in the movies yet. Miss Elizabeth Banks, who literally saves Wilson from the overbearing control and medication of his doctor, and later marries him, is charming in her performance, my favorite work of hers since her amusing voiceover in The Lego Movie. The real stars of this movie, however, are two men that you never see on the screen. Eugene Gerty, sound designer, and Nicholas Redbeck, supervising sound editor. More than anything, this is about the creative process of music and sound. And the director bravely starts this movie with a dark screen for several moments. Only sounds come from the right, left, and center, and surround speakers, priming your ears for the rest of the feature to focus not just on the visual impulses, but to savor and notice the aural ones as well. This treatment, and audience conditioning, as it were, was my favorite part of this experience, and I'll go as far as to predict an Oscar nomination for sound recording. It was superb. This likely will not be a great film for all time, but one that was a very poignant look at fame, celebrity, genius, and trying to remain human. I suggest you see it. The Motion Picture Association of America has given this a PG-13 rating. This is your pal, Matías Bombal, bidding you a fond farewell.